we thank you for the opportunity to be in the church. And we thank you because you are God every time. You are God in every situation. We thank you for this blessing to be just to worship you together. We thank you for the moment of worship and praise to you. Holy Spirit, as we share your word, activate this word in our hearts. And let this word be spirit, let it be life, let it be light to us. We thank you, we bless you, in Jesus' name. We pray and believe, everybody says,
Amen.
Amen. Now I want to share on our topic, the church in the end times. The church in the end times. I've been looking forward to share the message a bit on the end times. Now, God is a God of beginnings and endings, if we can put it that way. God is a God of beginnings and endings. Revelation 1 verse 8 says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. This is repeated in Revelation chapter 22 and verse 13. It says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Now the Bible is saying that it is God that began the beginning. Praise the Lord. The beginning began with God himself. It is him who began the beginning. And we are also saying that he is the end. The end is the one who determines the end, is the one who determines the beginning. Genesis, the book of Genesis, is a book of beginnings. The beginning of the universe and all creation. Before the universe, God was. And even if the universe ceased to be today, God will still be. He will still be Jehovah Elohim. He will still be Jehovah El Shaddai. He will still be Jehovah Elyon. He will still be God. Praise the Lord. The book of Ecclesiastes, I want us to read chapter 3, verse 1. Now the Good News Bible, the Good News Bible, says everything that happens in this world happens at the time God chooses. I would like you to write that the Good News says that everything that happens in the world, in this world, happens at the time God chooses. Happens at the time God chooses. Other versions, like the King James says, to everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven. Under heaven. But I want to subscribe to the Good News, which says everything that happens in this world happens at the time God chooses. In other words, everything that is happening is determined by God. It is God who chooses when it should happen. It is not in the power of human beings. It is not in the power of Satan. It is in the power of God. So you would be asking me, did God choose Corona to be at this time? I would say yes, because it is in his power. Praise the Lord. It is in his what? It is in his power. It is in power. What is happening now? Did God choose? Yes. God must have chosen that it happens at such a time. Of course, with a purpose. Amen. Amen. Our God does not live in a time frame. That's what I want you to know. He does not live in a time frame, but we see that he works in a time frame. And you can see this during the time of creation. In Genesis chapter 1, we see that God took 6 days to create, to create the universe and what is in it. So God does not live in a time frame. Bonus question. But human beings live in a time frame. Human beings live in a time frame. And that means that time is important to us. Time is important to us. 10 years from now, you may not be the way you are. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You may not be the way you are chronologically. And in other also aspects of your life, time will have gone. So time is important. Time is important for us human beings. You don't just decide to live your life anyhow, maybe. Time is very important. It's good to ask yourself, where am I coming from? And where am I going? Where will I be 20 years from now, if Jesus tarries? Where will I be 15 years from now, if Jesus tarries? Praise the Lord. So we don't have time to waste. The young people who are here, we don't have time to waste. And those also others who are here, every time we have, we must use it and use it maximally. If Jesus was to come 5 years from now, will you have fulfilled your purpose? Will you have lived out your calling as a believer? Will you have done what Jesus or what God sent you to do on this earth? If Jesus came after 10 years, are you sure you will have done what God sent you to do? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, somebody.
Amen.
Amen. So, man lives in a time framework, and we have said, therefore, time is very, very important. The Bible says that with God, one day is like 1,000 days, and also 1,000 days with God is like what? It's just like one day. I want us to read Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, I want us to read verse 1 to verse 5. Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1. Are you there?
Yes.
I want us to read together. Let us go. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Just a minute. God is creating the world, and the Spirit of God is doing what? He's moving. The Holy Spirit is hovering. The Holy Spirit is brooding. Another word is brooding. It's brooding the way a hen broods over eggs, provides warmth so that something can, life can come. That's the way the Holy Spirit was doing over the earth that, or the world that was without form. Let's go verse 3. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. Verse 4. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Amen. Now, these few verses we've read are very, very important verses. And they actually contain what we can say is revealed in the whole Bible. This is just a few verses we have read. Bona asifiwe.
Amen.
So we see that God created light from what we have read. God created light, and he assigned to that light separate segments of time, namely night and day. One last verse. Night and day. In John chapter 1, which I also want us to read, so that we can tie up what the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. John chapter 1. John chapter 1. And there, let's read from verse 4 to verse 9. We're in John chapter 1, verse 4 to verse 9. Let's go together. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. I want you to mark that. In him was life, and that life was what? The light of men. Amen. Verse 5. And the light shines in the darkness, and darkness comprehended it not. Verse 6. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light. Just a minute. The other verse has said that his life was the light of what? The light of men. But in this verse it's also saying that he that came was the what? He was the light. Amen. Let's continue. That we finish that verse 7. That all men through him might believe. Verse 8. He was not the light. That is, John was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighted every man that cometh into the world. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Yes, so darkness, I want you to darkness represents sin. Darkness represents sin. And Jesus, who is light, would come to extinguish that darkness. Would come to extinguish that darkness. Many times, the word darkness is used to refer either to sin or to refer to works of wickedness. When we use the word darkness. For example, in John chapter 3, verse 19 and 20, in the New Testament, the Bible says, and this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than light. In other words, men love sin, for they love wicked works. And the Bible continues there, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. John chapter 12, verse 46 says, I am come into the world, that whosoever believeth in me should not abide in darkness. Jesus has come as the true light, so that whoever believes in him cannot continue dwelling in darkness, or dwelling in wickedness, or dwelling in sin. Ephesians 5, verse 8 says, for you are sometimes darkness, but you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. What does it mean? Walk as children of light. Ephesians 5:11 says, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And there are many, many other verses we're talking about darkness. Colossians 1:13, 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 1-5, and 1st letter of John, chapter 1, verse 6, and many others. They are talking about darkness. So darkness representing sin, and of course, light representing the light of God or the righteousness of God. So God began by creating time to foreshadow the coming of the true light who lighted every man that would come into the world. It was a picture what God was doing, that when he was creating there was darkness, and God created that. And this light was pointed to the true light, who would be Jesus Christ. And once light comes, darkness normally disappears. Praise the Lord. Anytime you enter into a room holding a lamp, the darkness does what? Darkness must give way. Darkness disappears. Just disappears. So in Genesis chapter 1 verse 4, verse 14, Genesis chapter 1 verse 14, God made a portrait of his son in the heavens and he called it the sun. Amen. He made a portrait of his son and in the heavens and he called it the sun. Jua. Bwana sifiwe. And he made a mirror to simply reflect the light of the glory of the sun, and he called it the moon. God made a portrait of his son. Bona special. I'm just building a background as we come to talk about, as we talk about the end times of the last days, of the days preceding the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So God made a portrait of his son, Jesus Christ, in the heavens, and he called it the sun, and he made a mirror to reflect the light from the sun, and he called it the moon. Bonus question. The moon was a perfect picture of the church, which has no light in itself or of itself, but rather reflects the light that comes from the sun. Those of you who are geography students, you know that the moon has no light of its own. The light, what causes us to see the moon, is the light it has reflected from the what? From the sun. From the sun. And this is pointing to Jesus Christ and the church, that Jesus is that true light. Amen. The church, which is the body of believers, we don't have any light of ourselves, but we reflect the light of Jesus Christ to the world. And when we reflect this light to the world, people are able to know Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The Bible says that we are a light set on a what? A light that has been set on a hill, or a city set on a hill. People can be able to see us, and they can be drawn to God. So the sun and the moon representing the Savior and the church. So moon, sun and moon, day and night, were road signs to prepare man for the great conflict that would ensue between light and darkness, and that is the coming of the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. Last Sunday I was telling you that darkness and light cannot dwell together. Praise the Lord. In your estate, in your village, darkness and light cannot dwell together. You cannot live in that estate. You are representing God, and your neighbor maybe is a witch doctor, is representing Satan, and you are living comfortably together. It's not possible. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
It's not possible. You every day you are worshiping Jehovah. At midnight, you are engaging the gear of praise and worship and prayer. And him at midnight is moving around dancing in the night. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I mean, it can't happen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
One must give way to the other. And darkness, of course, must give way to the what? To the light. So the church of Jesus Christ is scheduled to dwell in the eternal light of God, which is not divided into time, it is not divided into hours or days or weeks or years. The church of Jesus Christ, as we wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ, we will be ushered into a realm where time is not divided into hours or days. Praise the Lord. As the Bible says in Revelation 21, Revelation 21 from verse 22, and I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it, and the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon, to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof, and the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it, and the gates of it shall not be shut, but all by day, for there shall be no night there. So we are looking forward for the church of Jesus Christ to be ushered into the eternal light of the light of God, of the light of Jesus Christ, where there will be no darkness. In other words, there will be no sin, there will be no wickedness. Praise the Lord. And this will be eternal. This will be eternal, and God will be the light. Will be the light of Jesus Christ, will be our light. We'll not need the sun, we'll not need the moon, and because there will be light throughout, the time will not be divided into segments the way we see today, that we have 1 day or 2 days, because it will just be light throughout. Hallelujah. There will be light throughout. So just as we look forward, we are looking forward to the coming back of Jesus Christ. The church is the light. Bonus special. And the light we have is the light of who? The light of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we are reflecting this light. We are reflecting this light to the world. So I want you to notice that as the church is about to be ushered into that light, which we are saying is eternal, a place where there is no mourning, crying, or sickness, or wickedness, or of any kind, no suffering, no dying, God is preparing the church to live with Jesus Christ eternally in the new Jerusalem. And therefore God will destroy the heavens, God will destroy the earth, and everything that is in them. But just before this happens, the church is passing through a period or a dispensation we are referring to as the last days or the end times. Hallelujah. Amen. The church is passing through a period or a dispensation we are referring to as the last days or the end times. It refers to the period preceding just the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord Jesus Christ.